icon, a globally renowned entrepreneur, and a 21st century leader whose words and work in the field of education and public service are inspiring a generation. President Barack Obama invited him to the White House. Forbes listed him on the Global Forbes 30 in the 30 list. The Rockefeller Foundation inducted him in the list of 100 next century innovators. The Nobel Peace Center invited him to the Nobel Peace Prize ceremony. The Queen of England included him in the Queen's Young Leaders. Sharad Sagar received his Mantra Diksha from Srimad Swami Gautamananji Maharaj, Vice President Ramakrishna Mission and Mutt in May 2018 in Rajkot, India. Born in a small village of India, Sharad went to school for the first time at the age of 12. Sharad received a full scholarship worth Rs. 4 crores to pursue his bachelor's in the United States of America. Sharad is quoted globally by influential leaders, corporations and startups, universities and governments, newspapers and media houses, and reaches over 10 million people annually. Powering his vision of creating a 21st century leadership to fight the 21st century challenges, Sharad has spoken on global platform and been invited to some of the world's most prestigious and influential institutions, including the United Nations, the World Bank, the White House, Harvard, IITs and IIMs. Sharad's work connects millions of students in India with education opportunities, and his organization has enabled young students to secure over Rs. 40 crores in scholarship from institutions around the world. I now request Sri Sharad Sagar to address the gathering.
I offer my pranams at the holy feet of Sri Ramakrishna Paramhans, Holy Mother Ma Sharada Devi and Swami Vivekananda. I offer my pranams to the revered monks of the order of Sri Ramakrishna. They are not just monks of the order of Sri Ramakrishna, but they are also the highest order of nation builders for our country. I also offer my namaskars to every teacher and student in attendance. And most importantly, before we begin, as we celebrate the annual day of the Vivekananda Yuvak Sangh, I think it is important to applaud the efforts of the volunteers and members of the Vivekananda Yuvak Sangh for putting it all together. I stand here humbled and blessed and inspired to the core, and I think that all of you who have come here for the first time today, how many of you have come here for the first time? I think you should give me company in being inspired and blessed. 127 years ago, a patriot monk spent some time on this campus in an auditorium that stands right across the place where he stayed, meditated, participated in discourses, and delivered his lectures to commoners who would come and be blessed by the words of this patriot monk. All across the world, from Nobel laureates to nation builders in India and across the world, people have been inspired by Swami Vivekananda. People have gone to places to try and witness, places where Swamiji stayed, lectured, meditated. And imagine how blessed we are to be seated in an auditorium right across the place where the patriot monk stayed 127 years ago. It is an absolute blessing for all of us. As I stand here today, everything makes sense. For many of you who see Swami Vivekananda as your role model, for many of you who hope to be blessed and inspired by him in your own individual journeys and collective pursuits, for me, that choice was not made by me. If at all you are blessed when you make a good choice or a good decision, you have been blessed one extra time than I have. Because in my name, Sharad Sagar, my full name is Sharad Vivek Sagar. Vivek comes from Swami Vivekananda. Sagar comes from Ishwar Chandritya Sagar. And Sharad, because I was born in Sharad Ritya. Long before I was born, my father, reading at the library at the Ramakrishna Mission in Patna, decided that he wanted to be a monk. But if he would be forced into worldly life and would have to take family responsibilities, he would name his children after Swami Vivekananda and he would make sure that they follow the path that Swamiji showed. So not surprisingly, when I was born, my name was pre-decided. I did not choose Swamiji. Swamiji had chosen me ahead of time. So when I come here, 127 years after Swamiji had spent time at this place, my name makes sense to me. But there is something else that is very surprising to many, but not at all to me. And that is that for the first 12 years of my life, I did not go to school. I was born and raised in small towns and villages of Bihar. In a place called Sirade, I was born. My relationship with Sirade is that I was born there. You share another relationship with this place called Sirade in District Sivan, State Bihar. The first president of India, Dr. Rajendra Prasad, was born in Sirade. But around 50 years after our independence, when I was born in the same place, schools and libraries were yet to reach this part of our country. There was no good facility for education, and my parents' concern how they would educate their children took one of the most audacious decisions a parent can go on to take. My parents decided they would teach us at home, and our education happened in a threefold manner. The first one, the one that I'm blessed with the most, was that in the small rented houses that we lived in small towns and villages of Bihar, on every single wall of the house, quotations of Sri Ramakrishna Paramahansa, Holy Mother Sharada Devi and Swami Vivekananda in English and in Hindi were pasted. And every morning when we woke up, we had to go around our small house and we had to read out these quotations aloud before we did anything. That was the first way in which I was raised, the first way in which I was educated. The second way was, my parents made it mandatory for us to read newspapers. And just to give you some context, newspapers used to come a day late in these parts of our country. And there is something related to that newspaper story, so I find it fitting to tell you that as well. The third part of my education was, my parents would buy notebooks and textbooks and they would bring it home and they would teach us, and the rest of the time they would leave it to ourselves to self-teach ourselves. This is a threefold way in which my education took place. And why I say I feel blessed and inspired standing here, because my story with the Ramakrishna Mission does not just start 2 years back or 10 years back or 20 years ago. It starts right from those teachings that I received at home, going around the house, reading the teachings of Swami Vivekananda, Sri Ramakrishna Paramahansa, and Holy Mother Sharada Devi. But also importantly, there is a very important story of my life that is related to a youth convention at the Ramakrishna Mission. I spent 5 years of my life in a place called Sharad. And one of the direct disciples of Sri Ramakrishna Paramahansa, one of the brother monks of Swami Vivekananda, Swami Adbhutananji Maharaj, was born in Sharad. He was in fact one of the only Hindi-speaking disciples of Guru Maharaj in those days. And in Sharad in those days, there was yet not a Ramakrishna Mission ashram. There was Swami Adbhutananda ashram. And my parents unfailingly every evening, they would take me to the ashram. It so happened that when I was 5 years old, a youth convention like has been organized here in Belgavi today, in Belgavi, many of you would still like to call it. A youth convention was organized in Chapra. I was 5 years old. A monk from the order of Sri Ramakrishna had come and he was supposed to deliver a lecture. My elder sister and my elder brother went to the youth convention and I was taken along as well. I was only 5 years old. My parents did not give up on me. But the people who were distributing the books of Swamiji to all the delegates, all the attendees of the convention, decided to skip it. They thought that a five-year-old child, what will he read? So they left it to themselves to decide whether or not I should be inspired at that age. But a very interesting thing happened after the lecture. All the young people like you who had attended the youth convention went to the Maharaj who was delivering the lecture. And they asked him for his autograph and they were getting the book signed. I was a small child. I also wanted Maharaj's autograph and ashram. So I ran somewhere in the office of the ashram and I took the center page from a Hindi copy, a Hindi notebook. I folded it and then I went to Maharaj and I said, I was a 5-year-old child, I asked Maharaj, I said, Maharaj, I need your autograph and I need your ashirvad. And Maharaj signed it and then he gave it to me. I went home, I told my parents, just like my elder brother and my elder sister have this folder in which all their certificates are kept, you please make a file for me and keep this autograph in that file. If I ever win certificates, you keep all those certificates in the same file. Fast forward that story, at the age of 12, I come to the city of Patna, a city for the first time, I go to school for the first time, and I do few other things, including the founding of the organization that was mentioned. But fast forward that story, around 17, 18 years later, I returned from the US, studied on full scholarship, the organization that I founded is continuing to grow, and we receive an invitation from Gujarat, saying that I have to be honored among these 12 youth icons of India, and a Swami from the Ramakrishna Mission would be the chief guest in me felicitating these youth icons. It turns out that the Swami was the same Swami. When I was 5 years old, Swami Nikleshwaranandji Maharaj, who is now the Adhyaksha of the Ramakrishna Mission in Rajkot, he was the one who had autographed that piece of paper for me. And when I was around 23 years old, he was the one who was going to felicitate me as a youth icon. And when I told this story to my teammates, who had briefed me that this is the invitation that had come, when I told them this, they know that I do not lie, but they all had a smile, they had a feeling that I was making up a nice story. And I wondered, people who I have worked with, if they find it so impossible to believe that this autograph can be preserved all these years at this auditorium, the Deendayal Upadhyay Auditorium in Surat in Gujarat, where there would be around 12,000 people in attendance. What if some young people doubt it? So I went, there were way too many folders by now, but the first folder, the first page, the autograph was still there. I took it out and I decided to take it with me. I reached Surat. Maharaj was meeting the awardees before felicitating them, and he was asking us if he was meeting us for the first time or the second time. The awardees included Padma Shri Anunima Sinha, the first female amputee to climb Mount Everest, also an initiated devotee of the mission. Oh, in fact, she is also initiated by Srimad Swami Gautamananji Maharaj, who is the Vice President of Ramakrishna Mandal Mission. So Maharaj was meeting all of us and he asked me, am I meeting you for the first time? I told him, no Maharaj, I am meeting you for the second time. And he said, your face does not look familiar. And I told him the story and he said, I cannot imagine giving an autograph to a 5-year-old child. And then we discussed all the details and he said, you have all the proof in terms of date, time, place, even the autograph. Yes, in some cases I have autographed it for children, but I have asked them to read Swami Vivekananda only when I give the autograph to a child that is small. But this, being here at a youth convention, speaking to you reminds me of the youth convention that I was a part of. So when in Kannada, very little of it I could make sense of, but I could understand that the three people who you heard, they were all sharing their stories of being a part of the Balak Sangh or the Yuvak Sangh, or their own experiences in their journey, how they've been shaped by reading the Ramakrishna Vivekananda literature, by the guidance of the revered monks of the order. So it all makes sense to me, but that is a youth convention story to begin with. And I hope that many young people, for you, just like it was for me, some 18, like when I was 5 years old, this youth convention goes on to be a turning point. And I know that in our television discussions, in our newspaper articles, in social media blogging, we read about the word turning point a lot. And it is also fitting that we are at the Ramakrishna Mission using the word turning point. Because if you look at this, in a country that houses some of the most enormously talented, dedicated, devoted citizens, it is important to look at Swami Vivekananda and try and understand the role that Swamiji has played in the journey of this country. We also celebrated the 126th anniversary of the Chicago Address only a few days ago. Now if you look at it, we live in a world where civilizations have been lost, where languages have been forgotten, stories lost somewhere, and more importantly, even people in families, when they pass away after a decade or two or after 5 decades, neighbors begin to forget them. Sometimes even family members forget those who were family to them only a few decades ago. But it is remarkable that 126 years later, not just India but the world celebrates a speech. And for that reason, you need to know and you need to understand the turning point in Indian history. 126 years ago, when Swami Vivekananda stood in Chicago to deliver that speech, the proud Red Fort still did not have our child. It was still unlawful to assemble in some part of India and sing our national anthem or talk about independence. Our generation of freedom fighters was still getting ready. The father of the nation was on his way back from South Africa to India. The first Prime Minister of India was only 4 years old when Swami Vivekananda stood in Chicago and he started his speech with the words, "Sisters and Brothers of America." And this global confluence of leaders burst into applause for this patriot monk from India. People count words and minutes. Some would say these were the first 4 words that made everybody applause. Some would count the number of words and they would say that, okay, this was all that Swamiji spoke. Some count the number of minutes and then some refer to the rhetoric. But it is important to know that the Chicago address does not continue to influence people all across the world because of the rhetoric of Swamiji. It was a refinement of personality. It was a person who was delivering it. And it was not just the transformation of Narendranath Tagore to Swami Vivekananda. But it was the great blessing and education that he had received at the holy feet of Sri Ramakrishna Paramahansa. And if you look at Swamiji, that is the reason why as young people we need to understand what Swamiji's message to us was. I get to work with middle school and high school students all across the country. I get to lecture at some of our most prestigious engineering colleges and management colleges. And no matter what the discussion, I tend to quote Swamiji. And it is important to know 2 things. The first one is, often I am not impressed if somebody says, and there is no reason for me to be impressed by any person, but by impressed what I mean to say is, all of a sudden I do not give in when somebody says, oh, I am very inspired by Swami Vivekananda. There is something that you need to know. It is not who you like. It is why you like that person. It is not who you like someone. Who you like as someone. But why you like that someone. And that is something that we need to understand about Swami Vivekananda. If it is one quotation that inspires you, that is good. But that is not good enough. If it is one Chicago address that lifts you up, that is good, but it is not good enough. If it is because looking at the picture of Swami Vivekananda, you get inspired, of course, billions of people get inspired looking at Swamiji and reading a few words. But that is not good enough. Especially as a country that stands 65% young. Especially in a nation where the discourse and discussion is pointed at the fact that the 21st century will be an Indian century because we are younger than any other country. Especially because Swami Vivekananda all these years ago asked where the manas are. Where are the people who build this country? And for that reason, that momentary elevation is not good enough. For that reason, just liking Swamiji is not good enough. Swami Vivekananda does not need a pat on the back. He does not need promotion. He does not need a stage. And he does not need a medium. He does not expect something from you for himself. He expects your best from you for yourself. And that alone can transform the journey that you've embarked on. That can be your individual journey to be a doctor or an engineer, a management leader or an able advisor in the future. That can be your own collective journey to transform our nation to its fullest potential. As a young child, when I began reading Swami Vivekananda's quotations up in the morning, going around the house and reading those quotations, and then the books of Swamiji that we were supposed to read. As I continued to grow older, I began to make sense of who I was made now. And that is important because I know even today, when you've come from different colleges in your city, it is important to see how you see Swami Vivekananda. Do you see him just as a monk or just as a patriot monk. It is important to know that Swami Vivekananda, one, he's called a patriot monk because not long after he left Belgavi, he was in Kanyakumari meditating. But he did not meditate on a god or a goddess, he meditated on the past, present and future of India. That is why the remarkable patriot monk is so close and dear to those who love this country so much. But it is important to note, and I was mentioning when I began to make sense of the patriot monk who I was named after. In the patriot monk, I saw an intuitive scientist who on one end could engage Jagdish Chandra Bose in our own country and Nikola Tesla in the United States, where he would share the space with him at the Chicago Address at the World Parliament. And remember, it is important to note that the World Parliament of Religions was not just a Parliament of Religions that was called one day. America was celebrating 400 years of being founded. And that is a context for us, a little tough to take because we were not founded on a particular day. And we've been here for thousands of years. But when America completed 400 years, they wanted to celebrate that. And that is the reason why they invited luminaries from all fields. It was there that electricity was first put on display. It was there that the confluence of people ranging from Nikola Tesla to Swami Vivekananda happened. But this patriot monk had these long conversations with scientists as Nikola Tesla and Jagdish Chandra Bose. So in a patriot monk, I saw a scientist. But it was not just limited to that. I also saw an educationist whose views on education inspired the East and the West alike. In times when we talk about Western education or Eastern principles, Swami Vivekananda's influence on education and his thought influenced East and West alike. And then Swami Vivekananda did not just stop at being an educationist who could influence the world. It was only fitting that when he was on a voyage, he meets with the greatest industrialist of that time, Jamshedji Tata. And Tata was so inspired by Swami Vivekananda, he invited him to come and lead the Tatas. But Swamiji in turn would reply in a letter that would inspire Tatas to build the greatest fortresses of science and research in India, the Indian Institute of Science in Bangalore and the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research in Mumbai, the IISc and the IFR. And if you look at Swami Vivekananda, that is what is missing in our present day education. That is what is missing in our present day leadership. I was talking about my journey of being homeschooled. In those 12 years of being homeschooled, I had not seen a city and I had not seen a school. I did not know what a city looked like, so there was a city in my imagination. I did not know what a school looked like, so there was a school of my imagination. How teaching must be taking place? All these 12 years, when I would read the newspapers, and I was telling you that newspaper story for a reason. When I would read the newspapers about a child from Bombay or Delhi or Bangalore or Hyderabad who would receive a full scholarship or represent India at an international platform or win a particular competition, I would often wonder if I could also go and participate at these platforms. But I was not enrolled in any educational institution, so I could not compete at these platforms. So there was a small thing that I started doing. And even Swamiji talks about it. That is largely the power of habit. And that is the reason why as young people, let us pick up those good habits. And one good habit can be reading Swamiji at the end of the day. And we'll continue talking about it a little bit. But there was a simple habit I picked up. Every time in the newspaper I would read about a child who had secured a scholarship, won a competition, or represented India globally, I would write down the name of the competition. The name of the conference. The opportunity that came across. And I would write down the month in which the competition takes place, who can participate, and when do the applications go live. As much information I could extract from the newspaper. At the age of 12, when I first came to the city of Patna, when I first got enrolled in a school, I had this diary full of opportunities by now. Competitions in science, competitions in leadership, competitions in public speaking, essay writing, that happened at local, national and international level, month after month, year after year. And I started participating in all those competitions, and by the time I was graduating high school, I had the great privilege and honor to represent India in over 6 different countries. I won at over 200 different competitions. And many people in my school, in my local, in my city and in the local media found that applaud worthy. work as hard, who are as smart, who want to do as big things, why are they not at these platforms? Just like you would imagine as a child who had just been to Japan or South Korea, I would come back and I would tell my friends all the stories. From the flight that we took, to the hotels that we stayed in, the questions that were asked, to the ideas that were put forward. And many times I would find that my friends had ideas that were far brilliant than anyone who had put those ideas forward at that global platform. Many times my friends would know answers to questions that nobody answered at a national level or an international level competition. And I would find myself saying to my friends, oh, you should have been at that platform. You should have been at this competition. And so with that simple understanding, with that simple idea, as a high school student at the age of 16, I founded the Dexterity Global, the organization that I continue to lead with my teammates. Dexterity's idea was simple. We believed that if there is an opportunity that is designed for our children and youth, they should be the first ones to know about it, and they should be equipped to participate in those opportunities. This was the first part of thought that led us to the founding of Dexterity. But there was a second part of the thought as well. And that again was very simple. At these global platforms where we discussed the role development can play in transforming societies or lifting up communities, where we discussed how electricity should reach every village, how clean water should be a fundamental right, how young people should be given opportunities from a young age, I often found that the young people putting their views forward at these global platforms came from international schools and world schools. Those schools that you find in the outskirts of Indian cities that sometimes have a school fee that is 3 times or 2 times the average salary of a common Indian. And it was sad to see that the challenges of rural India or the opportunities that young girls can unlock in small towns and villages were being discussed by children who more number of times did not have those lived experiences. And there was a thought that continued to strike me, and that was that if a girl child who has seen that her mother goes 1.5 kilometers to fetch water, her lived experience probably gives her better solutions and deeper convictions to solve that problem and put her views forward than any other. That a child in a small town or a village who craves for the idea of development to also bring him into the main fold, that child probably will have brighter and better ideas than many other children put together who have not seen those challenges firsthand. The idea was simple, that the leaders who hoped to change this country or to lead this country forward needed to come from those places that face the challenges of leadership firsthand. And that is a larger message I'll leave you today with. And for that reason, this second idea of powering leaders in every walk of life, from every corner of this country, with a larger meaning of leadership, we embarked on that journey some 11 years ago, completely equipped and powered by the ideas of Sagar. The reason why I was talking about Swamiji and his holistic education, Swamiji and the path that he took, is very simple. Today, the idea of education in our country is so broken that some of you might have come today just because this will give you an extra grade or some attendance in college, or just because you were told that you have to go there. But this is an important and integral part of your education. The most unfortunate thing we can do to a country and its citizens is send an entire generation to school without ever asking them, why did we send you to school? The most unfortunate thing we can do to our young people is send them to college without ever asking them, why are you sent to college? The most unfortunate thing we can do to a generation is send them to a workplace without a purpose and just in the hope of a paycheck. All of us, most of us, if not all, went to school so that we can go to college. We go to college so that we can go to a workplace. We go to a workplace so that we can collect a paycheck. And we collect a paycheck so that we can buy something else. And clearly, we do not enjoy doing many of these things. Because the things that we enjoy the most, we do those things only for the sake of those things. We enjoy playing in the playground. But we don't go to the playground every evening with the hope of a Wimbledon trophy or a Cricket World Cup. We go to play in order to play. We go on a vacation in order to vacation. We go on a holiday only to go for a holiday. We go to an auntie's place or an uncle's place only to go and be with them. But school to go to college. We go to college to go to workplace. We go to workplace to go to pick up our salaries. We need to change that. We need to redefine our education. And then there's a second part to it. And that is a move that dexterity takes forward. Call, answering the call that Swamiji had for our generation. And that part is, the disservice we can do to a generation is snatch away the meaning of leadership from a generation. And that is something that we have successfully done. What does leadership mean to us today? Powered by primetime television and 9 p.m. media, leadership to us is so much about optics. I work with middle school and high school kids, and I ask them, what is your image of a leader? And they tell me that leader is someone who people clap for. A leader is someone whose name people chant. A leader is someone who successfully gets auditoriums filled and stadiums sold full. And I ask them, so is Hani Singh a leader? He is a musician, he is a singer. People clap for him, people chant his name. He sells out stadiums and auditoriums. Does that make him a leader? And then they go in this idea of self-doubt. And sometimes they say, if he is doing good things, he can be a leader. And it is probably only children who can come up with that answer, because we are all born learners and we are all born leaders. So what is this idea of leadership that we talk about? There's something very striking about dexterity. We work in the field of education. We connect young people with educational opportunities. We help them build their skill sets. We enable them to secure undergraduate and graduate scholarships. And we groom them as next generation leaders and entrepreneurs. And yet we do not call ourselves an educational organization. Dexterity's mission statement is simple. It says, Dexterity Global is on a mission to power the next generation of leaders through educational opportunities. We do not see ourselves as an educational organization that happens to work in this co-curricular field called leadership. We see ourselves as a leadership building organization that sees education playing a central role in building leaders for India. So what is this leadership that we talk about? In our public maidans, in our cities, smaller cities and villages, when I ask our young people in Hindi, how many of you want to become netas? Not a single hand goes up. The few people who raise their hands, other young people just laugh at them. By the way, I want to ask that question here. How many of you want to become netas? Around 1,000 people, 4 or 5 people are raising their hands. And you're all sitting in front of this portrait of Swami Vivekananda. This is the saddest thing that can happen to a country. But we have successfully done that. We have changed the definition of education. We have snatched away leadership. So inspired by Swamiji's ideas and ideals, those are two things that we hope to do. Redefine education and reclaim our leadership. So what does that look like? What is this leadership that we talk about? And remember, by the way, if only 4 people raise their hands to become netas in this country, like in this place right now, that is not your fault. There's a disservice you can do to a generation. And that disservice is, when you snatch away the education and leadership of the tallest leaders that the country has seen from the stories that you tell about them. In this country, we talk about the father of the nation. But there's largely two things that you hear about the father of the nation. On one hand, you hear that Mahatma Gandhi traveled across the country and talked about Satyagraha. And the only second story that you hear about Gandhi is that he was thrown out of a train in South Africa. And then if you look at it, even if you ask all the students, what else do you know about Gandhi? They just know, oh, Satyagraha, independence, and then he was thrown out of the train. But we are not told what Gandhi was doing when he was at our age, when he was in his 20s. You are never told that when Gandhi was your age, he was being educated at a place called University College in London, which was one of the best educational institutions then and remains one today. That Gandhi's education was not just completed at the University College London, but it was further built as he traveled across the country and made his journey a journey of seva and sampara, service and communication. That is what Gandhi's education was, that paved the path forward for Gandhi's leadership. But that is a journey we do not talk about. We have limited Gandhi to his walking stick, to his spectacles, to symbolism. When we talk about Patel in this country, we talk about the Iron Man of India. We recently have started talking about Patel bringing all the assets together and building the India that we see today. But we never talk about Patel's education at a place called Middle Temple College. We do not talk about him refining his oratorial skills and his ability to negotiate at the highest possible level. That this journey inspired by Gandhi and under his service was also a journey of service and communication, seva and sambhar, all across India. When we talk about Ambedkar in this country, we talk about a poor child who went on to write the constitution in this country. But when we talk about him, we fail to outline Swami Ranganathanaji Maharaj, who was the president of the Ramakrishna Mathan Mission, used to interview some people who had done phenomenal things in their walks of life. And he remarks on Ambedkar's journey that how incredible this person must have been, how great the divinity within him must have been, that he went on to achieve so much despite so many hardships. But it is important to know that when Ambedkar was at your age, his education was taking place at some of the most prestigious educational institutions like Columbia University in New York. And the important thing about Ambedkar to remember at this point is that his education was sponsored by Maharaja Sayaji Rao Gaikwad in Baroda, who was a disciple of Swami Vivekananda, whose service to this country can never be forgotten in form of that scholarship that would lead to a scholar who would build the founding blocks of our constitution. So that is important. By the way, is English as a language okay for everyone? Is everybody understanding? Is it simple enough? Okay, thank you. Your silence is either deep understanding or deep sleep. But deep sleep I'm not seeing. So, good enough. I'll try and fix it. So, when we look at people as Gandhi and Patel and Ambedkar and Nehru for that matter, who we just see as a position that first Prime Minister of India or a rose that he would carry, his education at Aero and Cambridge, his travels across the country, his communication across the country, that is something we choose to conveniently skip. So, when our young generation sees a Gandhi, a Nehru, a Patel or an Ambedkar, and they give up on it. Oh, these were very tall leaders, very few people are born that way, only they can go on to do these things. They are not doing anything wrong. They have not been told that the way to leadership in this country has always come through education. It is only those who use their education for service who went on to change this country for the better. And that is something that we need to remember. So this leadership, by the way, does not have to be the leadership of Gandhi on day one, Patel or Ambedkar or Nehru on day one. And by the way, remember, it was the first Prime Minister of this country, Pandit Nehru, who said that Swami Vivekananda is the fountainhead of inspiration. It was Gandhi who said that my love for my motherland grew a thousandfold when I read Vivekananda. That in Rabindranath Tagore, who wrote the national anthem for this country, he told people in India and abroad that if you want to understand India, you read Vivekananda. There is nothing negative about him, it's only positive. But remember that fountainhead, that stream flows from here. So we are blessed that we are in attendance at a Ramakrishna Mission today. But this is important that I break it down to the simplest possible things that you can do starting today. As we talk about redefining education, let us switch our education from going to school for college, college for workplace, workplace for paycheck, to ensuring that our education is a solution to a problem that India faces. Our education is a solution to a problem that our community faces. That has to be the idea of education. And then, leadership. It is simple. Leadership, and I would give you the definition before the example, has to be your ability to deliver value through your limited expertise. Whatever limited capability you have, the value that you create through it, that is leadership. So what is this leadership that we can take as an example? Tomorrow somewhere in Karnataka, tomorrow somewhere in Gujarat or in Hyderabad, a child who does not know very good English or does not know very good Hindi, but knows limited Kannada, limited Gujarati, limited Telugu, if that child meets with an old woman who needs a widow pension card, and that child in its regional language writes an application for that old woman, that child is a leader. Somewhere in Karnataka tomorrow afternoon, after the government school gives over, a standard 10th girl child who waits after school for 5 extra minutes to help a standard 8th girl child with 2 math problems, that child is a leader. Somewhere in our playgrounds this evening, one child who helps another child learn how to play badminton better, that child is a leader. That is the leadership that India needs. That is the leadership that Swamiji talked about.
Science. They say in this country, when the first prime minister
heard Lata Mangeshkar sing patriotic songs, the first Prime Minister was moved to tears. If that is not leadership through music, what is? And obviously, this entire generation of freedom fighters, innovators, leaders, bureaucrats, politicians, all who have been inspired by Swamiji. If that is not leadership redefined, what is? So that is the leadership that we need to embark on. And that is the reason why a generation is sent to school and then to college. That is the reason why a country looks towards us. One note after the other. That is also leadership, by the way, keeping me on track. So, if you look at it, that is the idea of education and leadership we must take forward. I was talking about Kalam, and we talk about Kalam and Rameshwaram often. The little told story of Rameshwaram, and I would largely pause with that and we will enter into question and answer so that I can make the best use of my 50-something minutes that I have. But when we talk about Kalam in this country, and how he transformed this country as a scientist and a statesman, there is this very little told story about Rameshwaram that I would like all our young friends to know. In 1964, a cyclone struck Rameshwaram. And there's only one bridge that connects Rameshwaram to mainland India. It's called the Pamban Bridge. When the cyclone of 1964 struck, Pamban Bridge came falling down. And it was an important mode of communication. It was the only thing that connected mainland India to Rameshwaram. So the questions were being raised even in the Parliament of India. How quickly will we connect Pamban Bridge to the rest of the country? And a 30-year-old civil engineer was given the task of connecting Pamban Bridge with mainland India. When this 30-year-old civil engineer spoke with his seniors and asked them, how quickly can we fix it? I have been given 180 days. They just laughed and said, not possible to fix Pamban Bridge in 180 days. But this young man continued on this journey. And interestingly, on the 45th day, when the Parliament of India once again raised the question, what is the status on Pamban Bridge? The gentleman, the parliamentarian answering that question, got up without having checked his numbers. He said, within 1 month it will be fixed. Don't worry, within 1 month, Pamban Bridge will be fixed. Only to his surprise that next day newspapers in this country would have the story of a young civil engineer who, against an allotted 180 days to fix Pamban Bridge and connect Rameshwaram again, had finished that task in 46 days. This young civil engineer would go on to repeat the same feat in building some of the greatest infrastructure projects in the history of modern India, including the most challenging railway line in the Konkan Railways, and what is India's pride and the world's envy, the Delhi Metro. And that was E. Sridhar, who had that task at the age of 30. Now there is something very important about E. Sridhar. At the end of E. Sridhar's career that seems never to end, he continues to advise metro projects, he continues to lead from the front, but there was a book that was written on him. The biography of E. Sridhar could have easily been called The Civil Engineer, but it was not called The Civil Engineer. It could have been called The Metro Man of India, but no, it was not called The Metro Man of India. The biography of E. Sridhar was called The Path Literally Swamiji Wanted All Young People to Take. The biography of E. Sridhar is called The Karma Yogi. And that has to be the purpose of our education and leadership. Karma Yoga, the path of selfless action. And that is something that without making a lot of sense of a lot of things that have been given, the reason why Swami Vivekananda is such a fitting ideal and role model and guide and philosopher and friend for a young person is because Swamiji does not believe in complicating things, he believes in simplifying things. He gives you the simplest path forward, how to be the best version of yourself. I was a 5, 6, 7 years old child. My father would often ask me, what do you understand from the quotations you read of Swamiji? And the answer I used to give him was, an answer that has not changed. I used to say, Swamiji has said, build yourself to build India. Transform yourself to transform India. And that is a simple message you can take. And moving represent a majority of that. How many of you listen to very good motivational videos? Raise your hands. See, almost everyone. That is like 60-80% or more. I go to schools and colleges today where teachers tell me, our students are wonderful students because they watch motivational videos and listen to motivational speakers. And that for our teachers and students and parents is a very good thing, but it scares me a lot. And it scares me for a good reason. How many? So I have a couple of questions for you before you ask me questions. Okay? If there's a child who's 4 feet tall and we make him stand on a 2 feet wooden block, what is his height now? Standing on a 2 feet wooden block, the child is 4 feet tall, what is his height now? The smartest audience I've ever seen in the country, else even IIT sometimes they say 6 feet. So the answer is 4 feet. The applause for yourself is the smartest. So that is the height now. The child is still 4 feet tall. We have built a culture where children wake up in the morning, young people wake up in the morning, and they're not feeling motivated. So they go to YouTube and they search how to stay motivated. And then 10 million videos come up, they click on the first one. There is somebody who's now fast talking about motivation. And then that person says, get up in the morning every day, say 5 times, I am motivated, I am motivated, I am motivated, you'll be motivated. And you're doing those simple, stupid tricks, just hoping that you're going to transform yourself. We've entered a culture where auditoriums are sold out, and there'll be somebody who'll be standing and speaking, where that person says, one day I was walking down the street, and all of a sudden, I saw this dog. And in adjectives that even your English teacher has not taught you, he will define the dog. Like he'll just tell you what kind of a dog it was. Sharp teeth, bright eyes, like this big a dog, whatnot. And then all of a sudden this person will say, that all of a sudden I saw this dog started chasing me. And the moment the dog started chasing me, I am running and the dog is running, I am running and the dog is running, I am running and the dog is running. This person says the same thing 6 times in the same breath. And many of you listen with the same attention, not realizing he practices that every evening. All of a sudden this person will stop and this person will say, and all of a sudden I stopped. When I stopped, I saw the dog stop. And then I looked at the dog, the dog looked at me, I smiled at the dog, and the dog started smiling at me. And that was the moment when I realized that when a problem comes to your life, you smile. And young people like you, next day you have your term exams, your annual exams, your grade exams, your job interview, you're sitting down and you're smiling. Out of context lecture, out of context motivation, and a person who has probably not even followed that himself or herself in that journey. So what happens in that case? We have created this generation. I ask young people, if a remote control breaks, what do you do? If a remote control has broken the TV remote a little bit, what do? You tape it, right? I go to some places where extremely rich kids study. They say, buy a new one. So I say the entire premise has changed now. But when a remote control breaks, you put a tape on it. That's usually called a man-made solution. You are not a remote control. And Swamiji saw this 120 years ago, 130 years ago. So when you are feeling unhappy, you don't need a motivational video how to stay happy. When you are feeling not dedicated, you don't need a motivational video how to stay dedicated. You need to build yourself inside out. That video can inspire you for 5 minutes, that can inspire you for 6 minutes, but you said the thing that is the most right in the entire interaction we have had so far. That video is a 2 feet wooden block. Your height will still remain 4 feet. your momentary elevation is 6 feet. That is called chhanik uchai, chhanik yatai. That is momentary elevation. That is 6 feet at that point. Your height will still remain 4 feet. So how do you go from 4 feet to 6 feet? By eating the right food, by engaging in the right exercise, by working hard, by maintaining a diet and an exercise. That diet, that exercise, that continuity comes from reading Swami Vivekananda. That comes from seeing Swami Vivekananda as a role model in life. If he could give the generation of young citizens in this country to go on to become greatest freedom fighters, he can also lift you to be the greatest generation of doctors and engineers and bureaucrats and nation builders. So that is the reason why this small motivation that you take from these small videos that have infiltrated a market called motivation, it is important to go to the source, what Swami Vivekananda called living at the source. So please begin doing that, and most importantly, remember this dog story is actually a story that happened in Swamiji's life, but it involved monkeys and not dogs. It happened in Kashi, where monkeys had decided not to let him walk forward, and it is a story that is in a lot of books, which is called Face the Brutes. But Swamiji did not just say face the brutes, he gave you a path to move forward through which you could build yourself so that you could face anything. So leave that outer consumerist market world of motivation, start that inner journey with Swami Vivekananda at the core of it, as your friend, philosopher and guide, as your guiding light, and redefine your education, put that purpose back in your education, and start your journey of leadership today itself. Thank you so much. Jai Hind, Jai Hind. If you have a question, I think we can take a couple of questions.
Sir, aap kuch Hindi mein kuch boliye.
Hindi mein?
Hindi mein kuch.
Meri Hindi jyada Sanskrit ki taraf jhukti hai, is karan mujhe pareshani hoti hai.
Chalega, chalega.
आप सवाल जवाब अब हिंदी में कर सकते हैं, आपको पर बात पूरी समझ में आई? आप जोर से हाँ एक बार बताएं। बहुत अच्छी। मैं जब हिंदी बोलता हूँ तो हिंदी ज्यादा शुद्ध हिंदी हो जाती है, ज्यादा तत्सम शब्दों का प्रयोग हो जाता है। मैं आधुनिक मॉडर्न आपको शायद बेहतर समझ में आता हूँ। मैं हाईस्कूल के बच्चों के बीच में कभी कभी जो गुजराती मीडियम हिंदी मीडियम बच्चे होते हैं उनके बीच में कभी कभी मैं कहता हूँ कि आधुनिक उपकरणों का प्रयोग, कहते हैं सर सर सर। बट आप सवाल अपने अंग्रेजी हिंदी जिस भी भाषा में आप चाहें पूछ सकते हैं। मैं आपसे क्षमा चाहता हूँ कि मुझे आपकी इतनी अच्छी भाषा नहीं आती है, परंतु आप सवाल अगर कंप्यूटर में भी आप चाहें तो आप सवाल पूछ सकते हैं और कोई ट्रांसलेट कर देगा, मैं अंग्रेजी या हिंदी में बता दूँ, पर आप अपने सवाल पूछ सकते हैं।
क्या हम भगिनी निवेदिता जी को दूसरे स्वामी विवेकानंद कह सकते हैं?
सर का एक काफी प्यारा सवाल है, क्या हम भगिनी निवेदिता, सिस्टर निवेदिता के रूप में आदमी को जानते हैं, उनको अगला स्वामी विवेकानंद कह सकते हैं? इसका जवाब मुझे लगता है स्वामी विवेकानंद ने खुद दिया था। स्वामी विवेकानंद ने कहा था कि उनका कार्य 1500 साल तक चलता रहे। उन्होंने कहा था आई बी वॉइस विदाउट फॉर्म। उन्होंने कहा था कि मेनी विवेकानंद डू दिस वर्क। So, Sister Nivedita, Swami Akhatananji Maharaj, the revered monks of the order, they're all doing Swamiji's work. They are all doing the work with Swamiji's energy and ideas. So, and Swami Vivekananda to shayad khud ya bahut pasand nahi aaya hota ki koi vyakti Swami Vivekananda bane. Wo chahte ki wo apna best level pe bane. Sister Nivedita apne highest level par thi. Swami Akhatananji Maharaj apne highest level par the. To bilkul usi tarah, but of course Swamiji himself he'd be voice without form. So many people, including people like President Kalam, they were all voice without form. They all did Swamiji's work, but they all went on to become who they were at the highest level. Thank you. Next.
Responsible.
should not affect us personally. Very nice. One, nobody has asked you to defend the wrong way. That is not what law school teaches you. Right? So, allow me to make two comments on this. The first one is something called a larger narrative. So, there's a lot of larger narrative about things. And this is usually floated using Facebook and social media. So, when you say lawyer, a lot of young people think, oh, lawyer, kya kaam hai, jhoot bolna. Galat cheez ko sahi tarah se bolna. Ye to kahin likha hua that a lawyer has to say exactly wrong thing in the right manner. You see your responsibility as a lawyer. In a country that runs on rule of law, in a country where everybody is supposed to adhere to the rule of law, imagine the greatest responsibilities of lawyers to see whether people have adhered to the rule of law. But remember, law is not just limited to the court cases that we fight, to the sites that you put forward. It is also involved in engaging with things like RTI, which is right to information, in PILs, the public interest litigation. And if you look at it, in the farthest of villages in this country, there are people for whom something has come, but they don't know about it. They don't even know about right to information, which is one of the most like incredible things to exist in the law infrastructure in the whole world. Even like there are a lot of advanced European Western countries that do not have the equivalent of a right to information. So those are ways in which as lawyers you can engage with the civil society. How you can equip them with tools, how you can better represent them. What does a manager or a CEO do? They represent the larger aspirations of the consumer. They represent, what does a politician do? In the parliament, they represent the larger aspiration of a constituency. Just like that, a lawyer has to see what are things that I can equip these people with. And if needed, I will represent them in court for on these different issues. But as a lawyer, and remember, our generation of freedom fighters, most of them are lawyers. If you just pick up and you start looking, most of them are lawyers one after the other. So as a lawyer, and again, two wrong people are not fighting for this. There's always a right side. There are millions of cases pending in India. That in itself says and shows there are enough cases that you can pick the right cases. So right for the fight for the right people, fight for the right causes, and make sure that you also engage in producing the next generation of lawyers, in preparing people with a lawyer mindset right from the beginning. Bill Clinton, by education, was a lawyer, but he went on to be the president of the United States. So are there skill sets that equip him better? Of course, critical thinking, research, communication, these things, you can build those into as skills into younger lawyers who want to be in your position tomorrow. You can enable them to get better. So one is handhold and mentor those who are younger. Second is engage in the right cases and in the right causes. Third is see the application of law outside the court as well, because this country is run on rule of law. There you can play important role through RTI, through PII, through engaging with citizenry day in and day out. So you have a great responsibility. Please take it forward. Thank you. Just a second, sir. I'm told I can take only one question. Is it all right if I prefer a student over you? Thank you. Yes.
Good afternoon, sir. Do you believe that smoking or alcohol makes man negative?
Makes man?
Negative.
Makes man negative? Okay, that's a very good question. I do not smoke or drink. And people ask me in the US, I spent 4 years in doing my bachelor's in the US, and a lot of young people would ask me, why do you not smoke or drink? Is there a religious reason? And I used to say there's a personal reason. I would not want to do something that I consciously knows that I consciously know damages me. And second, I would not want to spend a single second in my life when I'm not in control. Imagine how helpless you are when you are not in control of your mind, body, and senses. So clearly, if I ask you, I'm going to take you to the fourth floor and I'm going to push you, why do you say no? If I say I'm going to push you from here, will you jump? You would say yes. Why? Because from here you can control that flight, because it is only 3 feet. If I ask you the same thing, that I'm going to push you from the fourth floor, you'll say no, because you'll have no control over your after only fate will decide where you go. You do not have the control over that fight. So for that reason you say no automatically, because you also like to stay in control. But if there is anything that takes away that control or your mind, body and senses from you, why would you do something like that? If there is something that damages you, why would you do something like that? And I know at the end of the day, trying to rationalize things, you can make all kinds of stories around it. But the truth, your body knows. The truth, your mind knows. So I will not even go to the degree of commenting whether it is a positive act or a negative act. It is a damaging act. Something that damages your mental senses is bad. Something that damages your body and its immune system, that is bad. So clearly this needs no science and no spirituality. This needs common sense. This is not a spirituality question. This is not a science question. It is a common sense question. And if you feel it is a rebellious question, no, it is not. Not at all. It is something which is a very good common sense issue. With knowledge we change. And I hope that, and this is, since it is the last question, I want to leave with this final message. We have become a generation with very strong views and very weak values. Where our views are very strong, our values are open to change. Oh, values, I was honest till yesterday. Tomorrow I write an essay on honesty, I forget one sentence because I memorize it. With full dishonesty, I write an essay on honesty. That is compromising. Right? So what I want is, our views should be open to change. Our values should be strong. Very strong values, views open to change. When we were children, we thought it was okay to pick up a little bit of soil and eat it. But then we had knowledge. We stopped eating soil. Do you eat soil now? Soil for breakfast, soil for lunch, soil for dinner. No? Right? Why? Because your views changed as your senses grew, as your knowledge grew. So your views on everything from politics, your social sciences, to everything that about habits and actions, they will change as more knowledge grows in. So this again is not a science or a spirituality issue, it is a simple knowledge thing. Whatever damages your body, whatever damages your ability to stay in control, do not take it. So I will not go as far to comment even on positive or negative, because that is entertaining the question. I would just leave it at this being a damaging thing. So you should not do it. You want respect from everybody? You want respect from everybody, right? Eventually. When you do that, you're not respecting yourself. And a person who cannot respect himself, would you respect a mother who does not respect a child, who gives the child a little bit of poison to drink every day? What kind of mother she is, right? So a mother who's not respecting the child, you do not respect that. A person who's not respecting the body, can you respect that person? No, right? So in order to build that respect for yourself, you have to carry yourself with respect, other people will respect you eventually. Okay? Thank you so very much. Jai Hind.
Thank you, Sharad, for such inspiring words, and I hope you are all rectified. The last one that you said on the knowledge and changing value, Muhammad Ali, the great boxer, once said, a person is not a true person if he doesn't change his views with updation of knowledge. So with that, I would like to thank you, sir. Sharad, it really inspired me and many of us here. I would like to bring up a few points that you made, and it really touched me and most of us here. So a few points were like, you gave the examples of Swamiji, Abdul Kalamji, and all of the great personalities, and how they have been successful. Especially Swamiji, how he was able to touch so many fields of education, knowledge, spirituality, nation building, and others. And as you rightly said, we all know Swamiji for his speech in Chicago. That was just like a climax, you can say. But behind that, there was a lot of efforts. There was brahmacharya, there was spirituality, blessings of Sri Ramakrishna and many others that helped him. That few words, even if we say it, won't make an effect. But when he said, that was 20 years of sadhana behind it. Like rightly said, that sadhana helped him. And though all the personalities that you said to had one common thing behind that was a spiritual base. The spiritual strong base. You know, Sri Sridharan reads Bhagavad Gita every day. All these great personalities have got a strong spiritual base that has helped them to go beyond what a normal man can do or normal man can do. So I would like to thank you once again, Sharad ji, and I would request the crowd to give us a round of applause.